It's a great show. It got me too. I was hooked on the show before I even knew I would be able to audition for the show. And there's just something about it. It kind of has aspects of like Game of Thrones and Walking Dead. And I mean, it just sucks you in. It's great storytelling that even fans that don't typically watch anime, they can appreciate the show.
I think that it's a really interesting show as far as the fact that it's not just anime fans that are into it. It has really crossed over into mainstream media, and I think it's really neat. And I personally believe that it's certainly all of the aspects that Bryce mentioned, but also, you know, the character development is so, so good. And just the ideas and the general themes of the show are so pertinent in today's society, like being a small entity or a small group that is marginalized and then fighting against the evil in the world, I think is a pretty common theme that's really popular right now. It speaks to society and where we are.
I have no idea. Have you read further?
No.
Literally, people who have read past where the anime go, they tell us that we know nothing about this show, and I believe them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what's going to happen to my character, and it's kind of exciting anticipating season two, seeing where our characters go.
And Mike McFarlane, the director, was, I mean, he, for me at least, and I think he's talked to you and Josh about it as well, but not knowing, for me personally, not knowing what's going to happen to Mikasa and going on that journey with her has been really exciting, and I can't wait to find out what happens in season two. I'm kind of terrified because then there's always those kids that are like, I've read the manga, but then when you die, like that's the worst. Yeah. It's like, do I die?
Anyone can die at any point. Yeah. That's where Game of Thrones kind of comes in, because they always kill off your favorite characters. So
Ned.
Yeah, there's always a target on every character in this show.
Yeah.
One of the great things about the show is that each character really brings something unique to the show. I mean, for each of you, what do you think is at the core of your character and what most resonated about it the first time you picked up the scripts for season one?
These are such good questions.
Yeah. do you want me to start?
Sure.
I mean, anger for Aaron, he's just angry to the core. From episode one, he's already an angsty little kid. And then once his mom is eaten in front of him, he's just full of rage and anger. And it was really cool for me to bring that side of me out, because I'm not usually that angry. Mm-hmm. So it was really fun to tap into that.
There's a line that Aaron says, it's, I watched the destruction of humanity, or maybe it's my line. I can't remember whose line it is, but I think that that's really interesting that your first instinct was anger, because it's not just that he's an angry kid. Like, I mean, he is obviously an angry kid, but like it resonates to why he's angry, like what's happening, and the fact that his mom died and nobody cared, and that's okay because they're in the poorer, you know, district.
Yeah.
It's so, and I think that every character has like this comment, like for Mikasa, I think I feel really drawn to devotion, her devotion to Aaron and to family, Aaron and Armin as her family, her adopted family, because of your anger and because you felt that the adults weren't doing enough to save Mikasa, you went out on your own because you were upset about it, and you used that anger and channeled that anger to like save me, and then my devotion to you sprang from that. I think it's really interesting that you went with anger.
Yeah.
Sorry, I'm just talking to my friend. I'm not even talking to you. That's not nice.
I have a favorite moment, and spoiler alert if you haven't seen it, episode 5, Aaron is killed and eaten by a titan, and I had no idea that was coming. Like I mentioned before, I was a fan of the show going in, so I was watching it in Japanese as it was coming out week by week. So there were only 6 episodes in existence. Aaron doesn't exist in episode 6. It's just a flashback. So I thought they really killed him off, and that's what really hooked me to the show, and I couldn't wait for the next episode to come out every single week.
Yeah, I think that my favorite moment for Mikasa was during, I believe, I can't remember what episode number it was, but it was when Aaron came to save her when she had been kidnapped, and she makes a decision, like, as Aaron is being attacked, and he's like, if you want to live, you have to fight, and it just clicks in her brain that that she wants to live, that she wants to fight, that she wants to soldier on. And that shift from like innocent, sweet little girl into a survivor, and then going back after like that whole sequence, and then going back and being like, I guess I'll go home where my dead parents are. And you're like, no, here's a scarf. And then like hearts melted all over the world because she murdered someone. All
right. That's anime. And anime.
Why do you think the rest of the world has embraced anime as much as it now has?
It's hard to say. I mean, it seems like there's always ups and downs in different mm-hmm. sort of genres. And I just think that there's been some amazing storytelling coming out of Japan. And these stories just somehow resonate through the rest of the world. It's hard to say why or, you know, how that has happened, but it just sort of has. And
I think the art has really evolved as well. I mean,
true.
The art and the graphics and the storytelling, of course, because what is a story without, you know, the words? But the way that it's just shifted, I think the last 4 or 5 years is a really good denomination because everything's just grown so much and changed so quickly and gotten so much further advanced. Like, And you know, not to get on a soapbox or anything, but, you know, gender roles and things like that and tackling these big societal issues in a way that people find palatable and also beautiful because of the art and interesting because of the characters. I think people are drawn to it because of that, because there isn't any, I mean, don't get me wrong, like, American cartoons are amazing and English cartoons are amazing, but they don't tackle, like, they might touch on issues like political or social or economic, but they don't actually like drive it home over and over. Like, there is a child and he is angry and his whole purpose in life is, and his whole drive is anger, and he's angry at the world that he lives in. And so many people can relate to that, you know? Well, the Legends of Korra came out, you know, what, when did it come out, Legends of Korra?
I think it was 2012, and I think it ended last year or the year before.
So in 2012, where were we? In 2012, we were just getting through. We were just getting through, like, the Great Recession, you know? Yeah. I mean, people were already dealing with enough stuff, so when you turn on the television, do you really want to deal with societal issues and stuff like that when you're struggling to pay your bills? Or do you want to watch some King of the Hill and Bob's Burgers?
Yeah.
Personally, I wanted to watch some Bob's Burgers, you know? Like, and there's nothing against Korra. It's just, like, I think that people are coming to a place in their lives. I'm just talking too much.
Go for it.
I think that people are coming to a point in their lives now, particularly in America, because I can't speak for the world. But as far as people that I know and things that I've seen, people are coming to a point where they feel more secure and they feel safer just in general. And so being able to have that security allows people to be more extrospective and introspective. And I think that they crave media that helps grow those things. And so that's why I think that, you know, some things are picked up at one time and some things aren't. Like, had Korra come out this year, would it have been more accepted and praised? I think it probably would have, but that's just me.
I would love to work on a show like SpongeBob. Yeah. Something, I mean, Attack on Titan is very deep, and I love working on shows like that. But again, something lighthearted would be fun for me. I watch those kind of goofy shows, so something like SpongeBob would be sort of my ideal.
It's so strange because anime is being driven more towards like deeper things. Like, when I get, like, I love cartoons. Like, I'll stop working on cartoons and go home and be like, oh, I need to unwind. I'm going to watch some cartoons.
Yeah.
Yeah. But like, oh my God, SpongeBob or Bob's Burgers or Archer. If I, like, come on. Yeah. Like,
at some point, hopefully, we are going to get a second season of the anime for Attack on Titan.
I don't know. Did I mention that? Did
I might have said something.
You might have said something. I guess the obvious question fans will have is that definitely happening? When's it going to happen? And if it does, what are you hoping for?
You know, I wish they told us more information, as voice actors, we're usually the last ones to know because we talk for a living and we'll probably say the wrong thing, so they just don't tell us anything.
That's true.
But we've been wanting a season two for a long time now, and they keep sort of moving it back and moving it back. And what we were told is they're letting the manga artists get even further, so they aren't filling that in and they're taking straight from the source material, which is good and bad. Mm-hmm. Good because, you know, we'll get an amazing story. Bad because we have to keep waiting. But eventually it will be here and everyone will be excited.
I mean, from what you've just said there, obviously a lot of shows start close with the manga and then because they outstrip it or kind of go parallel, is your feeling that they're going to be quite closely tied to the manga that people are already enjoying then from what you've just said?
I mean, it's hard to say. I believe that's what they're anticipating and planning, but again, who knows? I don't know what happens in the manga, and we'll see if the anime sticks to it.
There's currently a voice actor strike happening in the US. Again, apologize if it seems a bit...
What the F, man?
No, SAG-AFTRA video game strike, yes.
What are your thoughts? Because I think it's the last question I think we do, but what are your thoughts on that?
I think where the union is coming from is very well founded. When people see what the rates are, they don't understand that it's so difficult to get those roles. So you might have one day on a video game every 3 months, and it's impossible to live off of that kind of rate. And if you work on a game that goes out and makes billions and billions of dollars, TV shows, movies, all these other things give residuals, give a piece of that. So that's, one thing that they're asking for. But they're also demanding a lot of safety precautions. I don't do any motion capture. Have you done any motion capture?
I've done a little bit. I think that what they're doing is, you know, people, in my experience, a lot of people want to be voice actors. You know, I mean, every time we do a panel together, question one, how did you become a voice actor? Question two, how can I become a voice actor? And we are very lucky to have the jobs that we have, but we audition for every single job that we get. So it doesn't mean that just because you had that one video game that was amazing and great and totally hit it, that you're going to have, you know, job security, right? And to that note, like, safety is a big deal. I mean, it's, you can go in and say, they're like, okay, so we need you to come in for X amount of time, and don't worry, it's not going to be a lot of screaming. And then you end up screaming the whole day, and let's say you have a job the next day, and you're not going to physically be able to do it. Unions have been protecting American citizens for ever, and the fact that voice actors are saying, like, we deserve to have fair labor practices and we deserve to have fair pay, I think is fair. I know plenty of people who have been taken advantage of that just didn't know.
Knowing that the title of the game that you're working on would be another great thing to have, because there's so many times that I've worked and had no idea what that project is. Mm-hmm. And of course, actors sign NDA, so they shouldn't be talking about those things anyways. But it would change things knowing what project you're a part of.
Mm-hmm.
So I think what SAG-AFTRA is saying is very well founded.